Good afternoon. Woo! Holy moly, good afternoon. Good afternoon to you intellectual, adventurous creatures. God bless you for being here. Hello, welcome. My name is Andrew Russell. I have the absolute pleasure of being the producing artistic director of the Intiman Theater, and I thank you for joining us for a savage chat with Tony Kushner. The stranger appropriately said, our favorite gay icon talks to America's favorite gay icon. I don't know necessarily whose is whose favorite, but on stage together, their collective impact on the LGBT community progress, not to mention their artistic contributions, not to mention all of the intellectual stimulation and entertainment that they have provided. Let us hope that we have strong security, because if these two were sucked from our gorgeous planet, where would we be? So it is a special, special afternoon. I wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't thank the people that made this possible. Carlo and Leili Scanduzzi sponsored this weekend. Thank you to them. I thank The Stranger. I thank the Tom Douglas Company. I thank Elliott Bay Book Company. The sponsors of the Angels Project. I thank BECU, For Culture, National Endowment for the Arts, Seattle Office of Arts and Culture. These are not just a list. These are actual humans that make the work that we do, your bodies in this room, possible. So thanks to them. I also want to give you the... Yes! Yes! I also want to give you the heads up that you are being recorded by both the NSA and also us. So feel reassured that you will be heard. So we're recording you for YouTube so that other people who are not here can enjoy this amazing conversation. Also, the KUOW Speakers Forum is recording this. So please, if you have other friends who aren't here or who couldn't get in, please make sure that they have access to that. This afternoon launches the Angels Project, which is a series of performances and events inspired and anchored by a full-scale revival of Tony Kushner's Angels in America, which will be produced this summer, August and September, by the Intiman Theater. Tickets are on sale now at intiman.org. As many of you know, we now produce a summer theater festival every summer that celebrates diversity and celebrates issues that are relevant to our time. So boy, oh boy, it feels right to have Dan Savage and Tony Kushner here. I will give you a biography for both of them, although you probably don't need it, and then we will bring them on and we will all collectively hop onto a roller coaster, and I have no idea where it'll take us. Truly, these gentlemen just met backstage 30 minutes ago, and it was like, fireworks. Oh God, I just like almost quoted a Katy Perry song. This is the gayest, like there's like a gay pulsation out of this room right now. And if you're not gay, welcome. Welcome. This is a safe space. We'll help you through it. Dan Savage is an award-winning author, journalist, newspaper editor, political commentator, and so much more. His amazing books include The Kid, Skipping Towards Gomorrah, The Communist, he didn't write that, The Commitment. I don't think he did. American Savage and so much more. Through his sex advice column now for over two decades, he's been telling us how to do it right, thank God. And he also started the amateur porn contest called Hump, which is still playing right now at SIFF at the Uptown, so check it out if you're feeling adventurous. Did anyone in this room make a Hump film? Yes! So they'll be naked tonight. We would also not be doing our work if we didn't thank Dan Savage for launching, and his husband Terry for launching the It Gets Better project, which has transformed so many, so many lives. What a lot of people don't know is that Dan Savage is a recovering theater geek and started out in this world wanting to make theater. He returned to the stage in 2012 to do a drag version of The Miracle Worker called Miracle for Intiman, and it was wonderful to have him back on stage. Tony Kushner has written so many beautiful things. The plays include Angels in America, A Bright Room Called Day, Slavs, the gorgeous musical Caroline or Change. He's adapted Pierre Corneille's The Illusion, S.Y. Anski's The Dybbuk, Brecht's The Good Person of Szechuan, Mother Courage and Her Children. He did the English language libretto for the children's opera Brundabar by Hans Krause. He wrote the film Munich. He wrote the film Lincoln. He wrote the adaptation of Angels in America for Mike Nichols' gorgeous HBO film. He has done so much. To list it would completely take up our time, and I'd rather use it with him on this stage. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Intiman Theater, it's absolutely my pleasure to welcome to this stage Dan Savage and Tony Kushner.
So we've been talking for about a half an hour backstage about musicals. We could just keep talking musicals and...
Totally, I think that's...
really screw with these people.
We could sing.
I want to...
Sister.
I want to sing something from MAME.
Hit it. Go, I'll do
We'll always be bosom buddies, friends, sisters, and pals. I want to read a quote from Angels in America.
I once saw, I think it was Song Sisters, at like some New York Theater Award thing, and these two poor women came out, and one stuck her head out and went, sister, and the other one from the other side of the stage went, sisters, and Elaine Stritch was in the audience and said, can't you just smell disaster?
Nothing stinks higher to heaven than bad theater.
Yes,
you can smell that. You can smell it outside the building.
Yes,
when a bad
play
is going on.
It's the worst thing in the world. It's that great line from The Simpsons when Homer turns to Marge at the Mall of America, and there's some dancing thing is going on, and he turns to Marge. And says, I've seen plays that are worse than this, Marge. Plays.
Okay, speaking of plays, but good ones. This line in Angels in America, Rud Cohn says this. He's having a conversation with his doctor after his doctor has diagnosed him with AIDS. And his doctor suggests or states that he is a homosexual. And Rud Cohn rejects this, this label. To someone who doesn't understand this, homosexual is what I am because I sleep with men. But this is wrong. Homosexuals are not men who sleep with other men. Homosexuals are men who, in 15 years of trying, cannot get a pissant anti-discrimination bill through the city council. They are men who know nobody and who nobody knows. Now, Henry, does that sound like me? What he's saying is that homosexuals are powerless.
Was great. You've got the part. It's...
But they're powerless if they have no clout, they have no political sway, they can't make shit happen. Today in Arkansas, in Eureka Springs, gay and lesbian couples are getting married. The President of the United States supports marriage equality. The State Department has been fighting for the rights of queers in Nigeria and Russia, of all places. Seattle elected a gay mayor. In the 2+ decades since you wrote those lines, since you put those lines in Roy Cohn's mouth, what the fuck happened? What changed?
You know, I mean, we happened, the community happened. I mean, the LGBT community put up a very powerful fight. And you know, one of the glories of American democracy, I think, is this gesture towards inclusion. It was not necessarily exactly what the Founding Fathers planned, but there are the seeds of it in the original debates over the Constitution, in the legislation and amendments that followed the Civil War in the 19th century. A machinery was set up that allows for a social transformation to start on the grassroots level and then find its way into the halls of power and then actually transform those halls and the machineries of power and governance. And I think that that's sort of what we've been watching. Every single attempt to do this follows a different template, a different path. We actually sort of share templates. I mean, the African American civil rights movement is kind of the template for everyone trying to find a nonviolent way to effect radical social change. and feminism is indebted to it, lesbian and gay liberation is. But, you know, I think there's just been this, it's stupid for me telling you this, you know everybody as much as I do. I think there was, an incredible amount of courage and determination, especially in the generations that preceded my generation, the Stonewall generation and earlier, people who really came out at a time when it was, terrifying and lonely to do it. And, the unbelievable moment when the epidemic arrived, and rather than accept what the right was saying, which was that this was some sort of judgment against us rendered by, providence, the epidemic was not only faced and addressed, it actually was used as a moment to complexify and advance our politics and make sure that not only did we not go backwards, but that we moved forward through this biological catastrophe. There's nothing in all of human history exactly like that. I think it's one of the most extraordinary political accomplishments.
The LGBT civil rights movement?
Well, and specifically through the years of the epidemic, the ACT UP. I mean, I think that we didn't, I think that I certainly was afraid at that time that things were going to fall apart in the face of this profoundly disorganizing, nightmarish thing that was happening, and not only did that not happen. I mean, people who are a lot younger than me have forgotten things, like the separation between the gay community and the lesbian community, and how profound that divide used to be, and how one of the main things that bridged it, that made it go away to the extent that it's gone away, and I think that's to a fairly great extent, was the epidemic and the incredibly powerful and compassionate participation of the lesbian community in AIDS activism.
You have Roy Cohn pointing out in the play, which is set in during the Reagan administration in the 80s, is that the gay and lesbian community politically had achieved nothing. And even then, when the epidemic was raging, I think in addition to the many things that young queer people don't remember, don't know, and wouldn't have any way of finding out unless they were so motivated as to educate themselves, because they're not going to learn about queer history in their high schools, is the peril that what little we had achieved thus far seemed to be in danger of being yanked away from us. You had social conservatives, politically powerful social conservatives, calling for quarantine of queer people, of gay people.
William F. Buckley, tattooing.
Tattoo our buttocks and our arms. That was William F. Buckley's...
The great moral conscience of the American right. the evangelical right, which was at that point only really sort of climbing up on its, hooves and beginning to really find its place. I mean, the invitation of these crazy people into American politics was something that was begun essentially in 1979, 1980 by the Reagan campaign. And they were, using the platform that the Reaganites had given them to say, this is God's judgment against homosexuality. And when I remember one of the most powerful memories I have from the very early years of the epidemic, I was a member of a group called the Coalition for Lesbian and Gay Rights in New York, and we're the group that he's talking about in that speech. Every year, we would go to city council and ask for a non-discrimination bill, and every year we would lose. The Catholic Church would bus in a huge number of people from Queens. The Hasidic communities from Queens would come. And there was one great moment where I was sitting in the balcony at one of these that I went to, and there were these women from Queens praying on their rosaries against the bill, and then these Hasids sitting next to them, they were Lubavitchers, and Menachem Schneerson, the head of the Lubavitch movement, was testifying against the bill, and he pulled out a dollar bill from his pocket and said, "You see on this bill, it says, 'In God we trust.' This is a country is based on God, and it's in God we trust." And this woman, I'm not making this up, this Irish Catholic lady leans over to her friend and goes, "Ha, look at that Jew waving his money around." And they were like on the same side. It was just like that.
Well, the, The reason I ask,
and that's when I became a playwright. I mean, it was like, you really can't.
That's when you became a playwright.
It was perfect.
The reason I ask about that moment of peril, you know, I came out in 1980, and right into the buzzsaw is kind of how it felt. And there was that moment in like 84 where it just felt like what little we had achieved in visibility and some sense of security, even with our own families, was about to be taken from us. When you started working on Angels in America in the 80s and premiered in first production in 1990.
I started writing it in 88.
So the play itself, about really what was the darkest moment, I think, for so many queer people, so many gay people, is infused with such joy and such ecstasy and such optimism. Were you not ground under by that sense of despair, by that fear, by that moment of peril? Did the play, when you began to write it, was it darker and more despairing than the end product, than what you finished with?
No, I started working, as I said, in 1988, and things had already started to change. Rock Hudson had died, and as silly as it is, not that he died wasn't silly, you know, he was a nice guy, apparently, but it's kind of weird to think back on the history of the epidemic and the way that it was received in the American population in general. That was the watershed event. I mean, the fact that this guy, that everybody's mother had grown up loving in the 50s, was gay and died of AIDS, suddenly made this, at least that's the way I remember it, and I think when the histories of the epidemic are written, it's going to be seen certainly as a watershed moment. AZT was already on the scene, and even though it wasn't, God knows, anything.
Helpful.
Well, it wasn't the solution, and it caused as many problems as it created, but it was something that slowed down the absolutely, rapid progress of the disease from, I mean, it was the first thing.
So you were seeing glimmers of hope in 88.
Yeah, people were beginning.
I didn't see those glimmers of hope when George H.W. Bush got elected after the most hateful anti-gay, the political convention in 88, the Republican political convention in Dallas, wasn't it? Or Houston, was this rabid, it's where Pat Buchanan gave his.
No, that was 92.
Oh, was it?
Yeah, that was for me. I had this.
Marijuana's legal here now. I confuse a lot of things about the 80s and early 90s.
Pat Buchanan made the speech about this is the greatest, the Democratic Convention was the greatest display of ideological cross-dressing in America. And Molly Ivins wrote, his speech wasn't very good and it didn't go over well. I'm sure it sounded better in the original German. we miss her so much. I had this really strong feeling, I think everybody did, watching that convention in 92. He was saying all the things that those people were saying, most of them are still saying it, but it curdled in some way. I mean, it still got big barking laughs in the room, but it was curdling in some way. You could even see that Buchanan wasn't, he was a showman, and he wasn't happy with the way it was going over. And that's when I thought, Reagan was, Reagan was a sock puppet, but the people behind Reagan were very, very smart about how they rolled out the agenda. And it wasn't until Poppy Bush took over that he had to deliver on the promises. But Reagan brought the fundies in and gave them absolutely nothing. They expected a theocracy in return for delivering the South to the Republican Party, and they didn't get that. He was very cautious about, Angels in America was funded by the NEA under Reagan, and we were pretty clear about what the play was gonna be about. The big NEA controversy was under Poppy Bush because he had to start paying the bills that Reagan had incurred. He had to sort of start sucking up to the fundies and do the anti-abortion, the Rust Amendment, and all that, the gag laws, all that shit. That's on YouTube, I guess, now. But, I think that...
The first appearance of the word shit on YouTube, I believe. Shit makes its debut on YouTube. Jumping back for a second to Roy Cohn, was he a singular character in American politics, or are there Roy Cohns everywhere? Is Clarence Thomas a Roy Cohn? Is there a contemporary Roy Cohn for the gays? Or was Roy Cohn really a one-off?
Well, there are always people who are enormously compromised, who are living lives of immense hypocrisy, and every 5 minutes you discover that some hideous homophobe in some state legislature somewhere has been like that. What's the guy, where was he, in Kentucky or West Virginia? The guy who was a drag queen who's running for,
you know, running for Republican nomination.
And yeah, and his name was like Minerva St. John or something like that. And he was like a drag queen. And he's, anyway, I mean, you know, I was attracted to Roy partly because of receiving, when I was a really little kid, a kind of an education in the McCarthy era. I mean, I just got very interested in the McCarthy era when I was like 10 years old, and reading about McCarthy, and I knew at 10 that when I was reading about Cohn and David Shine, his boyfriend, that these were gay men. Nobody said it in print because he would sue you if you said it in print and just harass you with lawsuits until you wish you were dead. So people really stayed away from overt declarations about his homosexuality. But it was clear to me that he was a Jewish guy like me, and he was a gay guy like me. He was also a really terrible person, which I hoped I wouldn't grow up to be. And I was fascinated by that. So ultimately, I decided that I wanted to write about him because, I've said this a lot before, I'm a subscriber. I'm actually now on the editorial board of The Nation, and I've read The Nation since I first came to New York. Robert Sherrill, I think, was one of the old lions of the left, lion of the old left, wrote the obituary for Cohn when he died, and it was, as I remember it, sort of shockingly ugly and homophobic. And he really ends the thing, as I remember, gloating about what Roy's body looked like with the sores, and you know, really sort of like he got what he wanted, what he deserved. At one point in the article, sort of doing a little drive-by past the old theory that fascism and homosexuality have some sort of, you know, consonance, that there are always gay people mm-hmm. wherever there's something that smells like fascism, from Hitler to, you know, Reagan, and which is not as far a trip as I think some people think.
That's going to end up on YouTube.
Good. Well, I wrote a play. That's my first play says that. So
and twitchy.
You know, nobody can say anything that they haven't said already. You know, I think, you know, Greg Bordowitz, I think, was the person who said, you know, of the two people who died in the same year, Rock Hudson and Roy Cohn, which one died the more typical AIDS death? Who was the one who died with everyone jeering and no sympathy and alone? And it was Roy Cohn, even though he was a terrible person. So in a way, I found myself surprised after a lifetime of watching him and kind of hating him, being moved by his death. And also, as I started reading about him, discovering that he was loyal from the start to McCarthy. He never abandoned McCarthy, the memory of McCarthy. He never apologized. I mean, there was a kind of coherence. And I thought, oh, this is an actual character I can write because he makes sense to himself. He's not...
Were you worried when you created such a sympathetic character out of the tattered shreds of this man's life and his malevolence? In Angels in America, we love the anti-hero, right? Breaking Bad. We love the bad boy.
Because Breaking Bad
Roy Cohn is really the driver, particularly of the first play in the Angels of America.
He's pretty much, I mean, you feel more sympathy for him, I think, in the second when you actually watch him die. There were times when I thought, oh God, have I overdone it? But I, and I tried to make, I mean, he was a lot of fun to write. I got sort of worried because I really enjoyed writing Roy scenes. I think where he winds up and what he is, I mean, I was trying to get at something about American conservatism that's actually, you know, in some ways, not entirely. I mean, I think that conservatism is a thought disorder. I think that it's a. I mean, I really do. I really do. I think it's not like diagnosable, and you have to be like, you know, electroshocked out of it. But I think that it's an inability to construct, you know, a coherent causal chain that starts A, B, C, D, and that keeps going until you get to something that actually feels like truth. You stop at the point that it starts to get uncomfortable, it starts to, like, threaten your privilege, and then you just don't think any further. And it's, I mean, and it manifests itself in some people as a thought disorder, and in some people, as in the president before President Obama, as a thought and language disorder. I mean, where they can't actually, syntax falls apart. And you know, so I don't know. I mean, I worried about it. I mean, Breaking Bad is really interesting to me because what they did in that, it's like a, I don't want to do any spoiler thing, but, you know, it's a, he's not an anti-hero. I mean, towards the end, I think that they did an amazing job of, like, tying up all the loose ends and proving that in one of these new, because we are in a completely new age in television, where a television show can really be like a novel. I mean, you can literally carry it around in your pocket, which is how most people are watching it, and pick it up and put it down. And that's for people like me who have this kind of incurable problem of, like, long things. Well, you know what I mean. Anyway, that may explain the origin of it, but I don't know. It's not what I mean. The people who wrote Breaking Bad proved that a show can be conceived from beginning to end. I mean, Vince Gilligan says that's not what they did, but I don't believe him. I think they must have known. He must have known somewhere where it was heading, because it ends and it, everything's all tied up together. I think at the end of the show, in a certain way, they wind up trying to recuperate the Bryan Cranston character and make him into something of an anti-hero who still has a moral being. What was absolutely, and I love the series very much, I'm in awe of it, but the real stunner is that, I think it's the end of the second to last season, when they just sort of glide past the pot of poison on the, and you realize that this guy tried to murder a child. And all of a sudden, for me, and I think for a lot of people, You realize that you'd spend 4 or 5 seasons, because he's so brilliantly written and brilliantly acted, really wanting that guy to be a good guy, and really being unwilling to surrender to your conscience, which was saying, but he's already killed, he killed somebody in the first episode in self-defense, and then not in self-defense, and then, you know, this is a monster, and you've been watching a monster. It's like Paradise Lost. It's like Ben Johnson. It's like, you've replicated the fall of man. You've fallen in love with the devil.
While we're on the TV subject, Game of Thrones, yes or no?
Oh, totally. I'm totally.
RuPaul's Drag Race, yes or no?
Completely addicted to RuPaul's Drag Race. I want to be
am
a
I.
judge. But, like, you know, who do you have to
ben
fuck
DeLa
to get
Creme
to be a judge
robbed.
On RuPaul's Drag Race? That's what, look, I found a quarter in my thing. I want to be a judge on RuPaul's Drag Race, and I don't know how you'd do that.
I'll put in a word for you.
You've,
I was a judge.
You've done it. I remember you when you were a judge.
I'll get you on.
Like, how did, you know, I was sitting at...
Have you ever done drag?
I have never even tried it, because I know I would really not make a pretty girl. It would be...
Enough spackle paint and wigs, you can make a pretty girl out of anything.
No, it's... thank you, dear, but... I'm sure
they
you
made
that
a pretty girl
kind of
out of me.
No, I mean, I've seen enough people in drag who, and it's really like... No, you just really look like, you know, you don't want, you know, like, you don't want to look like, you know, so the rhinestone stegosaurus thing. I've never felt like I would be, I'm too self-conscious also. That's why I'm not an actor. I'm not very comfortable in my own body. But I love drag queens, and I love that show. I think that show is astounding.
I agree. That's the show I always point to when people complain to me about Modern Family and the representation on TV of gay men. It's always rich, white, upper middle class. And I always say, you want to see gay people of color, non-native English speakers, illegal immigrant gay men, gay people who've been to prison, poor, poverty, struggling, you got to watch RuPaul's Drag Race. That's where
although
there's
I have
this
to say
arc
my,
of gay representation.
Yeah, I mean, it is. It's you've never seen anything like it, and what's going on there with gender and the whole that weird thing with those guys, the straight guys who are getting married. I was like having trouble. The narrative was so complicated. It was like I couldn't. It was like French practically, and where the guy got. They made this guy was a basketball player, and he was in drag, and then he had to go off and throw up off stage, and then it was just unbelievably weird and interesting.
I love it.
I've been waiting though since I think it was the first season, the last Lip Sync for Your Life what was his name? Benet, the first winner of it.
Yeah. I'm terrible with names, and pot is legal here.
I'm thinking Stephen Vincent Benet, but it couldn't possibly be that. Anyway, they did that drag. Remember, they did like, and they did this whole sort of like drag improv thing about masters and slaves and. I was reading this whole sort of like Haitian Cuban colonization thing going on. It was this amazing, like dramatic, it was like a whole play in that lip sync. Watch it again. And they've never gotten back up to that level of complete genius, but maybe that can only be attained once in a lifetime.
So your really most recent play, The Intelligent Homosexual's Guide to Capitalism and Socialism with a Key to the Scriptures, which I don't think has been produced in Seattle yet.
No.
It should be. When I heard
it's in rehearsal right now at Berkeley Rep, so just down the road.
I will fly down. The Intelligent Homosexual's Guide, when I read that famous Adlai Stevenson quote leapt to mind, where he was running for president against Richard Nixon, and a supporter approached him after he gave a speech, and she said to Adlai Stevenson, "You have every thinking American's vote." And he looked at her and said, "Ma'am, I need a majority." The Intelligent...
I've never heard that. That's great.
The Intelligent Homosexual's Guide... It used to sort of be a cliche of like gay men were very cultured and well-read and intelligent. And I think that was sort of a product of you couldn't be out and gay and dumb because it was too dangerous a world to navigate out and gay and dumb. You would get picked off. It seems now that there are less intelligent homosexuals rattling around and doing fine. Do you find that to be the case? When you write The Intelligent Homosexual's Guide, do you see the intelligent homosexual as the majority?
I sort of believe that most people are intelligent. I think that real stupidity is actually a kind of remarkable and rare occurrence, as opposed to, as I said before, you know, thought disorders and things that make I don't think that W is genuinely stupid. I don't think that he's, you know, Mozart, but I think that he's not genuinely stupid, but there's something really, there's a major spanner in those works. I've met in my life very few people who I thought, oh, you're really actually just kind of a poodle. I mean, you're not really entirely, you know, functioning. You're just not getting it, right? So I don't know. It's taken from Shaw. I found it in my grandmother's library after she died. It's a book he wrote in 1939 called The Intelligent Woman's Guide to Socialism and Capitalism. And with the key to the scriptures I borrowed from Mary Baker Eddy, and a Guide to Science and Health. I love the title. The book is not as good as the title, but the title's really great. And for me, the intelligent homosexual thing was fun primarily because as a politics that's an identity politics and a politics of identity that's founded on desire and on the body and is inseparable from questions of the body and desire and all the sort of fluids and one of which you actually gave the name Santorum to, which I was like... Among the many great accomplishments.
My readers gave the name Santorum to that.
Right. Point. But you made sure that everybody, I mean, it was just brilliant. That was just amazing. And,
thank you.
I mean, you've done other things that, you know, are
that's going to be on my tombstone. It gets better except for Rick Santorum.
Santorum, right.
And salad.
Please don't put him on your tombstone. under your tombstone, maybe, but no. Well,
speaking of Republicans, today's Republicans more evil or more stupid? And is Michelle Bachmann a character you could have created? Is she Harper Pitt with a less attractive closeted husband and a less engaging personality?
Oh, no. Harper's like a really great person. Michelle Bachmann is really not. I mean, they are both married to gay men, but, you know.
You were just saying you've never met a truly dumb person. Have
She's
you met
not,
Michelle
I don't think
Bachmann?
Michelle is dumb. I think that, I don't think I could ever write Ronald Reagan as a character because I don't know exactly what the level of, what the DSM-4 category he would fit into or DSM-5 or whichever one we're on now. But there's something really, like, there was something seriously not hooked up inside. There's some kind of like as if personality thing going on in there. Famously, Edmund Morris, his official biographer, went into a massive depression. Compared him to in a memo to a convention of biographers. He said, I can't write this biography. I'm stuck. And I can only think of the president now as a glacier. He's thick, slabby, and cold, which is a pretty good description. And then wound up writing Dutch, which is this weird kind of fiction version, because he couldn't find Reagan anywhere in there. You can't make a really interesting dramatic character unless they're internally coherent, because their internal coherence means that you have to deal with your own internal contradictions and you have to reconcile them, you have to fight. If you don't have a core that needs to feel coherent to you, you can just be like, you know, fish on Monday and chicken on Friday, and you know, you can be anything, it doesn't matter.
There's so you think there's an intelligence at work behind Michelle Bachmann's demagoguery?
I don't think that there's much evidence that she's stupid. I think that there's great evidence that she's, you know, clinically insane. I mean, not that she should be, I don't know what her treatment should be. I'm not a psychologist, but the woman
she's married to one.
Yes, she is, I know. Isn't that insane? And has 750 foster, I don't know, but when we did the play, I wrote The Intelligent Homosexual's Guide at the Guthrie, and in Minneapolis, and I was walking in when the play was about to open. I was in downtown Minneapolis, and this bus drove by, and the poster for the show was on the side of the bus, and the graphic designer at the Guthrie had made the words homosexual and socialism the biggest words on the poster. So this bus came zipping by downtown Minneapolis, and I called my husband on the phone, and I said, well, you know, I don't know if the play is any good, I don't know what the reception's gonna be, but I have to say, I'm proud of that bus poster that just went by. And he said, you should feel proud, you've written a 17-word phrase of perfectly grammatically correct English that's absolutely guaranteed to give Michelle Bachmann a heart attack, and it doesn't have a verb in it. So, you know, I don't know. I think that, like I was saying, I think that for me, the hooking up of intelligence and homosexuality is, there's an interesting dialectic, I think, for us in our politics between, you know, it's the body-brain split that's been around since Spinoza, and we, that's a big part of our politics that I think queer theory has struggled with, that I think our culture has wrestled with in various ways. The whole thing that you're talking about, I mean, the need to be at least clever and crafty to survive under a blistering level of oppression like the homophobia that was universal up until Stonewall and then, you know, took its time fading since then, and then all of a sudden, very quickly, in the last few years, it's like a rout. I mean, it's really, it's stunning. But
I describe the gay rights movement as two simultaneous wars. There was a First World War happening where positions are dug in, and there's all this mustard gas, and the lines don't move much at all. But there was a guerrilla war, the culture war, and we were winning it. We were so far behind their lines. And then that sort of, the lines collapsed, and it was our triumph in the culture war, which was about being out to our families, about being out in our communities, about being out as a playwright. I've always looked at your work and thought, you know, if you were born 40 years earlier, you wouldn't have been Tennessee Williams, but you would have written plays like Tennessee Williams was forced to write. I mean, he's a crazy, demented product of his era, but he wrote in a code. He wrote straight people for the straight audiences who would not come see a play if there were gay characters on the stage. And gay people could enjoy Blanche DuBois as the faggot that she actually is.
Oh, I don't agree with that at all.
No, I think so. Not that I'm going to tell you about
the
American theater.
Tennessee is you know, one problem that I have with the idea that Blanche is just a drag character, first of all, you know, a big part of the job of being a playwright is an extension of empathic imagination into the lives of people who are not like you. And I think that Tennessee proved himself among many things, I mean, one of our greatest writers, to be immensely capable of imagining the inner lives of his female characters. He was one of the great writers of female characters. And, you know, Streetcar is a play about rape. And I think that if you, you know, it's, I think that's where I really part company with people that say that Blanche is a man. What the play is about, finally, ultimately, I mean, it's not about anything. It's one of the greatest plays ever written, and it's about everything.
Well, maybe but, the impulse is to find the gay stories in his plays because he wasn't, he didn't write gay characters, and part because you think he couldn't write gay characters.
He actually existed
at a time that you could.
Yeah, and the hard thing with Tennessee, I mean, you know, the drugs and the drinking destroyed him. Long before he stopped writing, he had graphomania. He kept writing and writing and writing and writing. And I used to think, I wrote the introduction for the Glass Menagerie 60th anniversary edition, and I spent a long time reading about him last year. And I used to think that that was a work ethic, a kind of courage. I remember when he died, Dan Rather on the CBS News saying, you know, very movingly, even though he got nothing but bad reviews for the last two-thirds of his career, he kept working every day, and I was really moved by that. The more I've come to know about him, the more I see that there was actually a kind of a craziness in the he should have written a little less, maybe. He certainly should have taken a lot fewer drugs, but, you know, who am I to judge? He was, I think the hard thing is that when he finally got to a point in history where he could start writing about gay people, he always wrote gay characters. Tom in Glass Menagerie shouldn't be played as an out gay person, but Tom is clearly gay. And the story that the play is based on, Laura at the end of the story outs him, basically says, you know, you brought the gentleman caller over because you want to do him. And I mean, she says it in a very subtle way, but it's kind of shocking. He didn't do that in the play. But Tom is clearly not necessarily straight, at least.
I've always felt that he should be covered in blood in the last scene during that last monologue because he's murdered his mother and his sister.
Oh, God.
How dark is that?
I No. Don't do that.
That's why I write in a sex advice column when you write.
Yeah, there is a...
In a 2009 interview, you were asked this question. You once said being a socialist is more stigmatized in our society than being queer. And you answered, I'm not sure that's true anymore. We've elected a socialist to the city council in Seattle, Washington. There is, there's now post-Occupy, this income inequality sort of awareness and movement, the 15 Now campaign here in Seattle to raise the minimum wage to almost a living wage. Do you think that socialism is about to have its breakthrough moment? Do you think people are beginning to see through the 30, 40 years of trickle-down bullshit that we've been sold?
I do. I think that it's really... I mean, when I talk about socialism, I'm talking about, I think, essentially being willing to acknowledge that there is a category of sort of an ontological category of economic justice, that money is not a moral free, ethic-free zone, and also that money is not the weather, it's not the environment. It's a human-constructed system that has a historical basis that evolves over time. It isn't God. And that economic justice is an absolutely essential correlate to democracy, to social justice, and everything else. And I was reading all these reviews of the Thomas Piketty book of Capitalism in the 21st Century, and which I've begun reading. It has algebraic equations like capital itself. I'm innumerate. I can't add and subtract. So I'm stumbling over that. It's amazing this book is now on the New York Times bestseller list. But what's astonishing is that, I mean, he's quite brilliant, and what he's proving absolutely has already been proved and has been said by people starting with, you know, Abraham Lincoln and like Mark Twain right after the American Civil War, and in a way James Madison long before, you know, that grotesque disparities of wealth are inimical to democracy and to human happiness. And it keeps getting proved over and over again. And I think we are shifting away. I think the Occupy Wall Street was a manifestation of it. I think that there are many ways in which the Obama administration has been very successful in pushing against the sort of prevailing Reagan logic that what we really are is a plutocracy, and our purpose for existing is to make sure that the Walton family has all the money on the planet, you know, and that they don't pay any taxes. But it's amazing to me how, given how much misery this monstrous idea has visited on the human race, how many people are still voting for it against, one of the great correlates, I think, is the vast majority of people who fought for the Confederacy during the Civil War were people who didn't own slaves. They were too poor to own slaves. And in fact, one of the reasons they were poor is they lived in a society that was essentially medieval, and they couldn't compete against plantations and slave owners. But they fought and died by the hundreds of thousands to defend slavery. And now you have, you know, the voting base of the Republican Party at this point, which is going to the polls over and over again to make people who can buy and sell them even richer.
There is a great phrase you use: people voting for their own impoverishment.
Yeah, and against
how do we
their
break
own
that? How do we, the trick with talking to these socially conservative Republican voters who are voting against their own economic self-interest, if there's any twinge of condescension, whether it's there or not, or someone can convince them that you're being condescending, then there's this reaction to go vote more Republican next time, because baby Jesus wants me to have an AK-47 and cocksucking dudes are evil.
Yeah, and I think some of that is really disintegrating, especially among the young. All the polls, even among evangelicals below the age of 39.
On the gay stuff, but the economic, the cultural identity, the tribal aspect to all of these people who are voting against their own economic self-interest. Oh. People in states where they didn't do the Medicare expansion under Obamacare, where hundreds of thousands of Americans, 17,000 Americans a year, are going to die because their Republican governors and Republican-controlled legislatures wouldn't take the federal money to
take federal money. Louisiana, my home state, which is, scores routinely at 60th in every national whole of everything
after American
and
Samoa,
it's just way under Americans. It's like Guam and American Samoa are like paradises compared to a lot of Louisiana, and there's this. But it's
how do the Democrats and liberals and progressives learn to play the tribal card? How do we learn to appeal to dumb white working class and poor voters?
Well, I don't think you want to build the politics on something cynical and pernicious. I don't think that that's ultimately possible to build a good politics on that. Here's the thing that scares me. The right and the left are two separate problems. For me, the problem of the left, and I've been saying this for the last 6 years, is that I think we've gotten very used to powerlessness. I think there's a certain comfort in powerlessness. You get to be pure morally and ethically and ideologically pure because you don't actually ever have to do things. So you can, in the laboratory in your own mind, you never have to ask questions about the NSA or drones, or we were talking about the war in Iraq. Those things are for other people to deal with. You know what you would do, and you don't have to deal with real-world consequences. We become essentially drama critics, where we never have to get our hands muddy. And then the minute we get into a situation where there's a real politics situation, like the situation that this current and, in my opinion, very great president was elected to address, we turn on him. Rick Warren speaking at the first inauguration, and suddenly, he's a sellout. He's worse than Bush. It's Republicans and Democrats are no different. That whole thing, we keep shooting ourselves in the foot over and over and over again by maintaining that
kind of
distance.
I would disagree on the queer front, because labor didn't get what was promised it in the first 2+ years of the Obama administration. The immigration reform movement, Hispanics and Latinos, didn't get what they were promised. We got what we were promised because people complained about Rick Warren, because people screamed and yelled at the president about DAT.
Yeah, we got what we were promised because partly because we fought for it unceasingly.
I mean, that's part of the fight was getting in the president's
But it was
face.
Also, yeah, but the president never didn't see it. There's no way on earth that anyone can claim that Barack Obama, who is a constitutional scholar, isn't capable of grasping the difference between marriage as a religious institution. I think he's probably read the Establishment Clause.
Despite what he said in 2008.
Yeah, of course, because he was the first African-American man running for president, and he wasn't going to come out in 2008 and say, I believe in gay marriage.
And I was on his side.
He would have lost.
I was on his side. I said then that the president pretends that he doesn't support marriage equality, and we pretend to believe him, which means we have to fight for it.
Well, that's a really good way to put it.
Frank Delano Roosevelt quote, I agree with you, you're right. Now go make me do it. And
right.
Queers were good at making the president do it.
Well, the president was also really good at figuring out exactly how to do it and when to do it.
I agree.
Letting Biden make that, you know, his declaration first, which softened things up. And then, you know, and then picking exactly the right moment after that to do it. And then, and this is why I love him, not just when he came out for same-sex marriage, coming out for same-sex marriage, but immediately including in his interview LGBT families, and therefore including immediately the whole adopt. He didn't make I believe in same-sex, I don't know about adoption now, I have to have more time thinking about what God wants. You know, he said, no, I mean, it was the whole ball of wax right there, because he waited and he had, I mean, I think, like all of our great presidents, certainly like Lincoln, who I've spent a lot of time thinking about, this absolutely uncanny sense of timing. And I think he played it exactly right. And I love the way that you articulate, I remember when you said that. And I think that's a beautiful way of putting it. The only danger is that while we're pretending to not, you know, to believe him in what he's saying and attacking him, first of all, not all LGBT people were, you know, really pretending. They were, I'm not giving any more money to the Democratic Party because, you know. But we're also, like, creating, I mean, we're about to go into a midterm election. There is some possibility that we might lose the Senate. If that happens, I mean, it's like, at this point, genuinely apocalyptic that we're wasting any more time about global warming, that we have another 2 years of listening to a debate about whether or not we can default on our loans. It's insanity. And if we don't take control of the federal government away from these mad people, we're really screwed.
We need to do nationally what the Democrats did in California. California is back on track. Its fiscal house is in order. Its economy is booming because the Republicans are entirely out of power.
Yes, exactly. After, and this is sort of goes back to what you were saying about the people on the right. You know, Marx had an answer, which is, you know, you have nothing to lose, but workers of the world unite, you have nothing to lose but your chains. He meant that literally. The reason that workers will unite as a class is because they have nothing except their oppression. When people lose everything, then they start to see things differently. So if we continue to elect people that are, and we start to have more and more meteorological catastrophes every year, and right, people will eventually start to turn on Ayn Randism and Reaganism and all of this insanity and malevolent horseshit. But the question that I always have, and I think that now with climate change, it becomes a much scarier question than even when our biggest threat was nuclear proliferation, which was a big threat, is are we able to learn without catastrophe? I mean, we had talked about the AIDS epidemic and that we, in the face of a catastrophe and working through a catastrophe, managed to turn what would have been a huge setback by any estimation into an actual conduit for progress. You know, the question is, can the human race change without
catastrophe,
Holocaust, piles of bodies? Is it possible to do that? Because we're facing now a threat that dwarfs all other Holocausts. I mean, because it threatens all life on the planet.
It makes me think of, I'm probably paraphrasing that. I hate to be like the quote machine, but that thing Winston Churchill said about America always does the right thing after exhausting all other options. Like, eventually we'll do the right thing on climate change.
Right.
Do you watch Vice? This is just a tangent. The Vice, a show on HBO, they had a piece last night about global warming, where they went to Texas, where there is this insane drought, The state is drying up and dying. Farms are dying. Ranchers are dying. And they walked around, they interviewed all these people, and like, they don't believe in global warming, they believe in Jesus. And if Jesus wants it to rain, it'll rain. Period. The end. And they have prayer meetings for rain, but they're not going to do anything about climate change or fossil fuels because it's not in our hands. We don't have that power to make it rain. Only Jeebus has that power to make it rain.
Although, you know, I mean, there's like, in any circumstance, if you believe in dialectics, there's always a thesis and there's always there's something that's going on that's not just depressing and terrible. And in the evangelical movement, I mean, I don't know exactly what's happened with it in the last couple of years, but I was following it for a while. There is this sort of notion of the stewardship of the earth, and that we actually have a responsibility to creation, not just domination over it. And among young evangelicals especially, and I think that one of the reasons that people like Rick Warren were brought in is because Obama was trying to reach out and make some kind of connection to what is, I mean, Rick Warren is a horror, but there is a way in which he represents a kind of slight shift in the evangelical community. I feel like, you know, there are changes in Christianity. There's the new Pope. I mean, who would have thought?
Oh my God, that's one of my questions. Wait a second. you're Jewish, I'm Catholic. How are you liking my new Pope?
I love him. I mean, I think, the churches, you know, they've been around for a long time, 2,000 years. They didn't survive all this time by being as stupid as they have sometimes seemed in recent years to be in terms of like how to, you know, handle a crisis. You know, you replace John Paul II, who was not somebody I was fond of, with the widow, Kate Clinton calls him the widow Ratzinger, you know, who is just, you know, a nightmare. But then they figured something out. You know, really, actually, with the pedophile scandal, you know, threatening actual schism at this point, we have to do something, you know, and Ratzinger bringing Bernard Law, Cardinal Law, to officiate at his, are you out of your mind? I mean, you didn't have to do that. I mean, it's like rubbing people's face in it. So he went away because of whatever he was doing with his butler or whatever that was.
Now he's the Dowager Pontiff. That's what we call him at my house.
Knitting. Yeah. I like to think of him knitting or making. Never mind, I won't go there.
Making altar boy cozies that just slip over them.
They do this periodically. They go, you know, we have to actually now get a human being on the throne of St. Peter, and so let's go and find a decent person. And they did it with John the 23rd. And John the 23rd, as astonishing a figure as he was not a completely, he was a politician, they all are, and he made compromises that are a little shocking now. He was a moderate, but compared to what had come before him, you know, ultra left and made huge changes. And I think this guy is positioned possibly to do the same thing. And I certainly, fingers crossed. I mean,
the proof is in the pudding. You have Uganda, this majority Catholic country, which is passing these horrifying anti-gay laws. They're arresting people for being gay, prosecuting people for being gay. It's basically just this state-sanctioned violence. People are dying. The sponsor of that legislation in Uganda is a Catholic woman, and you have the Pope saying, you know, who am I to judge if a person is gay and seeks God? The Pope has this opportunity in Uganda to stop it. The Pope could live up to if the Pope said, hello, Uganda, I'm going to start excommunicating people.
Well, I'm not sure exactly what would happen in that case. I mean, I think
he said nothing. I mean, who knows what would happen if he said that, but he has literally said nothing. And so for me, to my eyes, I look and think, pretty rhetoric. We'll see what happens with these conclaves are going to have about family, and they're asking questions about female ordination, asking questions about birth control.
Right.
Even us, the terrifying married homos who are coming to destroy the world.
Right. And what it results in, if it's going to result in, you know, papal bulls and encyclicals and all of that, and if he winds up excommunicating the horrendous right-wing clergy in African countries that are promoting this new wave of homicidal homophobia. You know, I don't know if he has a power base that can do that. He's just become Pope. It takes, it's a big transnational nation that he's in charge of, and I want to give him some time. I mean, I want to give him, you know, time to build. The way that the elections happen with the cardinal, the College of Cardinals, there's a problem with the it's not an electorate, so it isn't really a democracy. It's a whatever it is, and so I don't know about building, but John Paul II did massive damage to what remained of the progressive part of the Catholic Church under after Vatican II. He purged them. He moved them out of positions. He attacked liberation theology and discredited it and so on. So popes can have a tidal effect if Francis lasts long enough.
And I want to give him time, too. And I also want to tell him, please don't stand at the top of any steep marble staircases. I'm glad he's not in the palace. I'm glad he's staying in the hotel.
I just think the question is, I don't think those guys, I think the real princes of the church are very crafty, and they're not going to murder him. Because they have done away with John Paul I and so on. I don't know if he was murdered, but anyway, I mean, there's a possibility. It's fun to think about that. But I don't think they're going to. I think they knew who they were getting when they got him. I don't think he's a surprise to them. I think they wanted somebody who would put a human face on a church that at this moment really needs it. And
I welcome the refocusing.
What
the
I love is when you go to these right-wing Catholic sites who, before, if you said, I wrote a thing in The Nation, I guess, or The Advocate or something, years ago after the Matthew Shepard murder and the Pope released that, John Paul II released that appalling encyclical about we have to all be friends and we have to have civil discourse and be friends. And it was like, right, but you know, you're contributing directly to an atmosphere of dehumanization that makes it possible for horrible things like this to happen. And that crazy guy, the
Bill
Catholic
Donahue.
Defense League, what's his name?
Bill Donahue.
Bill Donahue came after me and said, next time, he wrote a letter to The Nation, the next time a hooker gets killed, I guess you'll blame it on the Pope. I said, no, I'll blame it on you. if you said anything, if you were Jewish and gay or whatever, you had the word, even Andrew Sullivan got all freaked out about it. It's like you couldn't talk about the Pope because it was, now you go on these sites and they are just slagging this Pope. It's like, who elected this guy? And he's saying the Pope is a fraud. And
Pope is a socialist.
Like, yes,
he
exactly.
called for the redistribution of wealth this week.
Just like and Jesus, go just figure,
like Jesus.
You know?
Hillary Clinton or Elizabeth Warren?
Both.
I'm for that. That's what I was for in 2008. My husband was so for Hillary, and I was for either or both. I was for Obama Clinton or Clinton Obama. We'll see what happens now. I was going to ask if this is, do you like musicals? We talked about that backstage.
We did. We both like musicals a lot.
Huge musical theater fags. So how come only one musical, Caroline or Change?
I've done the first act of a new musical that I'm writing with Janine Tesori, who this year with Lisa Krohn made a musical version of Alison Bechdel's masterpiece, Fun Home, which I hope will come absolutely... stunning, stunning, stunning.
I saw it. It was tremendous.
Isn't it? I mean, it's just unbelievable. It's so great. And Janine and I are writing a new musical, and so stay tuned.
Based on, do you want to say?
I don't want to write musicals based on things. Like Caroline, it was an original story. This is about the death of Eugene O'Neill. How's that for an
exciting
story?
The death of Eugene O'Neill?
Yes. I know, like really, that's a problem. It's like, But it's an interesting story, and I think the first part of it is really great. So
so writing for the theater versus writing for film, Lincoln, Munich. I really think that film and television have transformed our imaginations. I think we have very cinematic imaginations because we just imprint so heavily on television and film. What for you as a playwright or a screenwriter is more satisfying? I mean, you're both a playwright and a screenwriter. What's more satisfying? To see a fully realized, tremendous production of one of your theater pieces, or to sit in a theater and watch Lincoln?
Watching it is sheer hell for me, whatever it is. It's like, who wrote this and why? working on it, you know, I really love film. I love television. I think we established that we both love television. But I love film. It's a great art form. It's just a completely different art form. I'm really proud now that I've taught myself to write screenplays. I mean, I think with Munich and Lincoln, and, you know, working with a guy who really knows a lot about film, so it was I got a good education in it. And I think I sort of get what screenwriting is now. And I really enjoy doing it. And it turned, you know, I'm basically a bottom, so I like kind of having a boss. And playwrights are supposed to be, you know, or God. I mean, you own the thing. It's all property relations. And in screenwriting, I'm a writer for hire. And in playwriting, I own the copyright. So that I have, you know, not only the tradition of the theater that the play is the thing, but actually in court, it's mine. And you can rent it, but there are things that I won't let you do with it. So I've never had to exercise that. But
would you?
I almost did once. Over a pause that an actor was taking in a line.
A pause?
Yeah. But it was in the first production of the play, and the pause changed the meaning of the line radically, and it was one of the most important lines in the play, and he was doing it deliberately, and I told him not to, and I told the director to stop him from doing it, and the artistic director. And for the first time in my entire life, I went outside. It was a performance of my father, who died 2 years ago, was coming when he was quite ill from Louisiana to see the play. And I said, I'm very proud of this scene. This pause, in my opinion, is ruining it. Get rid of it. And just at least for this one performance, so when my father, and he didn't do it. So I was also, there was emotional stuff. I went out on the pavement after the show, and I called my agent, and I said, I want you to call the director of the theater, the artistic director, and tell him that if the pause is in, I'm not going to watch the show tonight, I'm going to send somebody to watch. If the pause is in tonight, I'm pulling the play. And the pause was out, and it never went back in. And I've never done that before. Well, don't applaud that. I mean, that's kind of ugly, but, you know, or go ahead and applaud. You know, yeah. Actors. But that's not an answer. I'm a playwright more than anything else. I really believe. I think I'm better as a playwright than as a screenwriter, and I think that I'm when I'm good as a playwright, it's because the thing that we talk about when we talk about the theatrical is where I live. It's an inherently dialectical form. It's really more about a conflict and a clash of ideas, of forces, than it is about a narrative. And everything that is on stage also isn't. So it teaches people critical consciousness. It doesn't really teach you about social issues. There are better ways to learn about those things. But it forces you into a room where what's illusion and what's reality are confused, and where you can only really understand the event if you're willing to read that question all the time and confront the ways in which the unreal can completely absorb you and take you in, and ways in which even while you're identifying what's not real or what's artificial, you can be moved and fully engaged as a person. There's nothing, it's just this weird contraption that we made up. Oscar Eustace, my very good friend who runs the public theater, always says it's not an accident that democracy and theater were both invented right around the same time in Athens. They both have to do with empathy, with compassion, with an ability to project yourself, and also I think with a degree of adult skepticism, critical consciousness. And I think that we came up with this gadget and we can't live without it. It's as essential to us as dreaming. And film does something that's also dreamlike, but it's a very different, and for me, a kind of scary force. It's like reading a great novel. Even though you're in a room of people in a theater, if anybody watches films in theaters anymore, the image is so huge and so overwhelming, and the ability to create absolutely convincing illusion is so overwhelming that I think it isolates you, and it makes you in a dyadic relationship with the thing, when you're in an audience in a theater, you're always aware you're part of a team doing battle with the people on stage. You're in an audience, and the person sitting next to you who decides that, you know, in the middle of the quietest moment in the play to have an emphysema attack is
a part of the
part
play.
Of the event. And unlike most drama critics, most people who go to theater know that from night to night it changes radically, and that's part of the fun of it. It's not this fixed thing. And it isn't anything. It goes away. When it's gone, it's gone. The thing itself, you can take pictures of it or put a video on YouTube, but that's not that thing. And that evanescence is...
Years ago, I was talking to a director, and I asked him who his favorite playwright was, and he said, a long dead one, because you can do whatever you want. And it's why, you know, Shakespeare's... When somebody does a shitty production of Shakespeare, people don't leave it going, wow, that Hamlet play, what a piece of shit, that Shakespeare guy can't write. They think, what a shitty production, and what a bad idea. Do you look forward to being a long dead playwright? Do you look forward... Do you look forward to a time when your plays are completely out of your control, out of your state's control, in the public domain, and people are free to do with them what people do with Shakespeare, whatever the fuck they want, on Mars in the 20s, cross-gender casting?
I don't stop people from doing that. I mean, I've seen productions of Angels in America that were, literally with people in ape costumes, and Roy Cohn on a drag bar dancing in fishnets. I mean, that's fine.
It's just that pause.
Just that one. No, I mean, I won't let that happen on the first production, because I think the first production has to be in some kind of concert with what I wrote. It will never be what I wrote exactly, because it's interpreted. I write scripts, I write scores for a kinetic event, and people can read them. I mean, it lives also as a book, but and it'll be redone, which is a lovely thing about it. When I had the first play I ever had done at the National Theater in London, I don't know if it's still there, but I was shown the day I arrived, and said, we're going to take you to the Living Writers' Room, which is this little tiny room, sort of off in a side thing, and it was called the Living Writers' Room. And if you're a living writer at the National, you get to go and sit in this room, and there's a little desk. And I opened the drawer, and somebody had written on a gum wrapper, "Abandon hope, all ye who enter." I've never found out. Was it Stoppard? Was it David Hare? Was it Coucher? You know, who wrote that? But I don't really look forward to being dead, particularly. except I'm tired. I think that letting people... I don't really... once the play has established some kind of foothold in the world, I think it's okay.
I mean, that is essentially what everyone knows. Everyone has sort of an Hamlet in their head. We know what Hamlet ought to be. So when you see the On Mars upside down production, it's riffing against sort of an established idea, sort of a cultural memory of sort of a proto-Hamlet.
Yeah, well, I mean,
and that's not going to exist unless you can direct the pauses.
The one thing
production.
You learn immediately, no matter what your occupation is, Shakespeare always wins. He's always better than you. He's always better than everyone. Anything you think you've done, I always tell my playwriting students, the one thing you must never, ever do when you're writing a play, when you're actually writing a first draft, is read or go to see anything by Shakespeare. Because you'll immediately find out that he already did it, whatever it is you think you're doing, and it was much better than you'll ever do. And just don't go. And I read like a few years ago that Goethe said the same thing. He said, if you're a truly creative person, you can only read Shakespeare once a year, because otherwise it's just too depressing. I mean, it's just... Whoever, well, you know who he was.
Or you
could
read
Shakespeare.
Or read King John, because it's a disaster.
King John is, except that I firmly maintain, I don't know that he really wrote King John, but anyway, every time I think, okay, but there's always, All's Well That Ends Well, or there's, Love's Labor's Lost, or there's this or that, and there's just nothing you can do with that. Somebody will do a production without doing terrible things to the text or setting it on Mars, and you suddenly go, oh, I was stupid. Of course, it's Shakespeare. So there it is. There's the play. I didn't see it before. Titus Andronicus. One of the greatest things I've ever seen in my life was Deborah Warner's production of Titus Andronicus with Brian Cox.
I saw that production too. At the RSC in the 80s in the Black Box.
Yeah, it was absolutely... I've never seen this happen anywhere in a theater before or since. It was Critics' Night. And in London, that means it's a stenographer's convention. They all come on the same night. All these little guys in these... Anyway, and they sit and they write the whole time. So it's a... And at the end of the big scene where his hands are cut off and her tongue is cut out and his son's heads are delivered in a bag,
The pie, when he dropped the pie on the table and it oozed out.
Well, the pie was later, but this is that first long horror scene, and Kenneth Tynan said it's a play that could only be of interest to a butcher. And I had seen so many bad productions that were just laughable. What Brian Cox did and what she did in that thing was so horrible that you thought, if this doesn't stop, I'm going to die because there's no air left. The depth of misery that he plunged into, I've never seen before, and I realized when the last line of that scene, it was right at intermission, was spoken, there was no writing going on. Even critics, were listening. And then the lights went out, and the lights came back up, and nobody moved, and nobody clapped, and nobody did anything. They just sat for like a weirdly long time because they were so shattered by it. And so now I think Titus Andronicus is
I love it.
Shakespeare. It's just...
Your husband, Mark Harris, also a writer, that must be very annoying. Because I know as a writer that when I'm like buried in a project and I'm trying to get it done, I have no social skills, I stop eating, yeah. I stop bathing. That,
yes.
I'm an asshole and a monster and I have to be left alone. I'm like the worst husband.
But you write
a
weekly column, so that's kind of scary.
Well, no, like,
that's
like... A weekly... A weekly advice column that the readers
you're
write
really
half
great
of?
The one day after you hand the column
no,
in.
No, I mean like finishing a book.
Yeah, no, it's true. It's true. I think you have to unhinge something really deep inside that makes you a social, presentable person to allow a world to kind of start to come out, and you unhinge that thing.
But if there were two of you locked in an apartment together who were both in that state at the same, do you guys coordinate so you're not both finishing books or projects at the same time, so one of you is the human being while the other is the monster? Or are you both monsters together at once, and how do you not throw each other out a window? Terry deserves like some sort of prize for putting up with me when I'm trying to finish something, because I'm just such a fucking... Sorry, K-O-W. I'm just such a jerk. Or are you nice?
Yeah, God. I mean, I turn into mostly this like hideous kvetch rather than a jerk. And the really hard thing with Mark is that he was, you know, a magazine journalist for 17 years before he wrote his first book. And so he has, and he was an editor. He's a brilliant editor, which was very smart of me to marry a brilliant editor. And he has an editor, a magazine editor's discipline. Like missing a deadline to him is like, you know, defiling the Torah. You just don't do it. It's beyond a shanda. It's the worst thing you could possibly do. And so when he started writing his first book, you know, he said, "I'm going to start writing on January 1st, and I'm going to write a chapter a day for." And he did a huge amount of research. And then he did, and I wanted to kill him because I thought, oh, well, he doesn't remember that January 1st, we always have this like brunch for his in-laws, his family. So he'll never get any writing done that day, and I'll get to watch him blow a deadline. The family came over, they stayed forever, and then they left, and he said, okay, I'm gonna go work now. And he went in and wrote like the introduction. And I really wanted it. That was like a dark moment for us. I thought I would just... And then I would go down to my office at the end of the hall, and he's in his, and I would sit there all day, you know, staring at the ceiling and talking to myself and reading books that I don't need to read and whatever. And then I would hear him padding down the hall and say, "Can I read you my new chapter?" And that was hard. That was really, really hard.
I couldn't take that.
No, we were talking backstage about how the really terrible thing, if you're a procrastinator like me, is learning that deadlines, they don't really mean what they seem to mean when you're young and you believe them, that there's a consequence. You blow enough of them, and you talk to enough other writers, and you realize everybody's always blowing them, and you start to think, well, that's sort of a vague description of when you should get to work,
yes.
Rather than, you know. The only deadline I have to honor is that when a play is in rehearsal, and the audience is gonna come in. I mostly can't stop that. A couple of times I have, but mostly they're going to show up.
For me, the terrible thing, and the person I'd like to find and kill, is the person who thought, oh, I know how to help people write more efficiently, write faster. This thing that they write on, this computer, this laptop, let's also make that the porn delivery system that just funnels porn into their lives.
Impossible, you know,
so you're sitting there like trying to keep the Word document open, knowing there's just like this infinite universe of porn one click away.
Or since I'm not brave enough to admit to that, I'll say that In addition to the, I've never been on a porn website, so I don't know what you're talking about, but there's also, like, if you're doing something on a historical, like when I was working on Lincoln, and I'm typing away, and I think, I wonder, you know, what kind of, there was a thing, the people in the telegraph office, I suddenly became obsessed. Well, did they have, like,
in the White House, those beautiful, like, scenes in the White House with the telegraph.
With the telegraph in the war room, and it was like, well, so what kind of pads did they write on? And, you know, now you're typing away and the deadline is approaching and your boss, who's very, very powerful, is saying, you know, I need this immediately, and everybody's waiting for it. And I think, I'm going to go look and find what kind of pads. When did they invent adhesive pads? When did they, you know, and you wind up, you know, 5 days later, you know everything that there is to know about adhesive and pads and stationery.
See, for me, it was double penetration. Now, when was the first time that happened? When was that first video uploaded to X2?
Historically speaking, when did double penetration really become a thing? And
we have a couple of questions quickly from the interwebs, and then we'll take a few questions. We've gone long, but we'll take a few questions. We didn't set up microphones, so when we get to audience cues, just wave at me and I will call on you. You will say your question, I will hear it, and then I will repeat it into the microphone, so you will have to be succinct with your questions. So from Christine via email, which of your other plays do you wish got as much attention and as many productions as Angels?
I think the play that I'm still probably proudest of, I'm very proud of Angels in America, is Caroline or Change. I really love it a lot. It's in a way easy to be proud of it because it's only half mine, it's half Janine's. I think she's a great composer and I think the score is astonishing. And but it's gotten a lot of attention. I mean, it has been everywhere except Seattle, weirdly, but it's been everywhere else. Otherwise, I don't really have any complaints. I feel like plays find the audience they're meant to find. I knew the minute Angels happened, it would never happen again in my lifetime to me, and that my obituary is going to say the author of Angels in America is dead. Hopefully not. Hooray, hooray.
We can put that pause back in there.
I was very close friends with Maurice Sendak, and we did a book together, and we went on a book tour where he signed it, and there was, you know, lines around the block of people, and they all had Where the Wild Things Are. Maurice wrote and illustrated over like 90 books, and wrote and illustrated at least 18, I think. And some of them are masterpieces, absolutely as great as Where the Wild Things Are.
In the Night Kitchen.
In the Night Kitchen, Higgledy Piggledy Pop, which is, I think, one of the great works about death and dying in all of Western literature and art. I think he was a great artist. And, you know, it was as though he had done this one book, and it was the one that everybody brought. And, you know, it used to pain him, but, you know, he also was like, okay, but I'd rather have that than not have it. And I feel that way. I'm happy. I Angels is still going strong, and that makes me very glad. So,
from Michael via Facebook, what is the most important lesson theater has taught you?
Trust no one. No, not really at all.
Leave it intermission. If it sucks, leave it intermission, because you can apply that to dinner, you can apply that to a marriage, you can apply that to a cocktail party. If it's bad, like, leave it intermission.
I don't know what the single most important, I mean, I sort of talked about that a little bit already, learning not to be a rude mechanical, learning to read the world, not to be a fundamentalist, not to be a literalist, to learn how to read critically, and what joy and pleasure there is in reading, in knowing how to read and watch and think critically. It certainly taught me an immense amount about community, because it is a builder of little sort of instant communities the minute the show starts, of a community of people who get together to make something. It's taught me lessons about how you can make something astonishing out of absolutely nothing. One of the great things about theater, it has this terrible economy of expression because there's very little, ultimately. I mean, the digital revolution has basically passed us by. We can do holograms and stuff, but it doesn't really work all that well. And essentially, the tools are very sort of Luddite, and don't cost very much, and you can spend a lot of money, and sometimes it's a good idea to do it, but you can also do incredible things with absolutely nothing but bodies and words and people watching. And I love that. It's also taught me, and I think this is why it's so unpleasant to watch. Not unpleasant, but you know, we'd all rather, if we're sane, stay at home and watch RuPaul's Drag Race than go to any play, even a great play and a great production, because you know, there's a safety in it. There's safety in watching a film. The actors will be doing the same thing in the film 2,500 years from now, if the film still exists and there are still people on the planet, which is not a given anymore. But you know, it is a commodity form in a way. It's fixed and it doesn't rely on you. You can't hurt it. You can hate it with an intense passion, and you don't have to feel bad for it because those people aren't actually present. Whereas if you're on stage watching a staged event of some schmuck who's struggling through a terrible play, you can't help but wish this person would just, the earth would open up and swallow him and start imagining evil things that should befall this person, especially if they're bad. And then you feel bad because you've turned into this kind of sadistic creep wishing harm on somebody whose biggest crime is a lack of talent or the bad luck to be cast in a bad play. But you're also, it's like, it's freaky to be in the presence of something that is not permanent, that is entirely human determined and boundaried and affected. And it reminds you of what human is in a way, how difficult intimacy is, how hard it is to be with, you know, not on the internet, but to be with another human being in a room, and how prickly and unreliable and scary it is. And I always love it in a play when an actor, I mean, I don't love it when they, especially if it's my play, if they forget their lines, but this amazing thing happens in an audience. If an actor goes up on a line and the audience gets it, and they get it quicker than anything, they could all be asleep and the play could be boring, but the minute an actor forgets a line, everybody's like this.
Because something happened.
And getting them back from that is incredibly hard because it frightens everybody, and that is an emotion. It's an enormously powerful emotion, and it, the fear that that's going to happen, I think, accompanies us into the theater. So I love that. It's not an iPhone. It's not a Lexus. It's human. It's a gathering place for a human community, and that you know. It also teaches me that people in groups, as opposed to what the right says, which is that groups are evil and stupid and, you know, unreliable, and individuals alone are the truth. You put 100 strangers in a room, they all become smart, like really smart, immediately. It's very hard to keep out in front of an audience. No matter how smart you are, you have to race, because they're, when they get together and they start thinking as a pack, they hunt really, really and it's, you know, it's proof that socialism is a good, I mean, that we are communal animals, so.
This question is from Mark in New York City. Why you still don't get that you have got to wash the food off before loading the dishwasher? I was DMing with your husband and asked him if there's anything you wanted me to put to you on stage today, and this was it. I was hoping for something a lot more embarrassing.
Did he really say that?
Yes.
Because the dishwasher actually gets most of the food off most of the time. And since I'm always the one who loads the dishwasher, were I to wash the time I would lose in rinsing off all the dishes all the time would add up to a lot more than the time that I lose washing off the occasional little sort of stuck-on piece of food and you know, fighting with Mark about rinsing the dishes.
It was really funny that that's what he came with. I was chatting with him earlier that the dishwasher is actually a point of contention in my marriage as well, because Terry believes it should be loaded in a very particular, meticulous, organized way. But he won't do it himself. He wants to do a tutorial once in a while.
Yes.
In a rage.
Maybe we're married to the same person.
I think we might be.
we have these like these plates that we bought, and every once in a while one of them has a little chip in it. You know, they're plates. We use them a fair amount, and Mark is convinced that they have the chips because of the way I load the dishwasher, that I'm not, they have to be kept like a foot and a half apart from each other. And that when we close the dishwasher, they swim around and bang into each other. And it's like, I think they just get chipped. Of course, I'm not really sure that I'm right. He may be completely correct. And every time I see a chip, I kind of, you know, put it on the shelf and then turn it so that he can't see it.
Well, maybe you and I should live together, and Mark and Terry should have conjugal visits, and we can have our dishwasher and they can have their dishwasher.
Except then you know that we'd like be serving them plates with like stuck on egg and like chips and everything, and they would gloat. So it's,
So are there any questions? We'll start with you. The question is wondering what you or I, either of us, both of us, have to say about the movement to achieve gender parity for playwrights across the nation.
I think that there's an absolute need for theaters across the country to make certain that gender and race also are not obstacles for really good plays to be done. The representation of women playwrights has changed so radically in the last couple of two or three or four years. I mean, just 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I think the Public did a season that was nothing but women playwrights. It was entirely women playwrights, and it wasn't called like the Year of Women Playwrights or something like that. It was just a season, and everybody in it. Annie Baker, who is a very great playwright, who just won the Pulitzer Prize, who I just think is astonishing, is, you know, part of a generation of really remarkable women writers who I think now are being done. So, as, you know, I think as much as men. I think that there's not to say that there's gender parity right now. There isn't. This is a tricky thing to say. I feel that, and I'm a man, so maybe I'm wrong about this, I feel that at this point, given the number of really important women playwrights in this country, there's going to be a movement, an unstoppable movement towards something like gender parity. I believe that when an oppressed group starts to use a form, any artistic form, any vessel that's been developed over centuries of tradition that had previously excluded them, the vessel has to be changed. You can't just move in and expect the vessel that was created to express the problems of, you know, white straight men to express your issues and concerns. And the reshaping of that vessel, the breaking apart and then reforming of the vessel to make it work to express somebody who's using it coming from a perspective that didn't shape it is always going to be, I think, a long and complicated and somewhat messy process. It feels to me that women have been, since the beginning of the 20th century, doing that work and making that happen. And I think we've arrived at a place where it seems to me that there is as much excitement about a great number of women writers as there are, as far as I'm aware, and I'm a pretty aware person of playwriting, as there are of male playwrights. You know, the problem is that theater is a form is popular entertainment, and there's a way in which it it's a meritocracy, not an egalitarian form of democracy. I don't, there are all sorts of institutional things that I think have to be fixed. I think that women playwrights have made a great deal of progress I think women directors, theater directors, have made less. I think that that's coming. There are now many more women directors than there were 10 years ago. Until there are a lot of women directors, there are probably not going to be a lot of women artistic directors. Until there are a lot of women artistic directors, there are going to be barriers to women playwrights and other women directors being hired. As an organized political campaign, I have some questions about it. I don't know because I think it starts to put a demand on theaters to adhere to some sort of quota system that I think is going to be automatically and immediately problematic, because I think the theater needs to do plays that work, and they should be plays that work written by Black people, white people, Jewish people, Christian people, Muslim people, women, men, you know, gay people, straight people. I mean, and I think that the regional theater movement has made that a possibility, making a representative. You can hear how nervous I am answering this question. So, you know, like, smile, thank you, because I don't want to sound like somebody, you know, and I know that it's an issue. I really get that it's an issue. But I think that if, you know, where the real fight, I think, is in federal funding for the arts, so that what started and what made this country's theater begin to represent the pluralism and the heterogeneity of our population is the regional theater movement, and the defunding of that, the stagnation of the NEA, is a great disservice to any group of writers from a community that had previously been underrepresented seeking greater representation. It makes theaters much less risk-taking. It makes it much harder for theaters to do plays that may not initially attract the same size. You know, serious theater has never existed in any civilization as a market, as an effective, you know, sort of market-driven thing. It's always had, even in the Shakespeare's day when it was selling a lot of tickets, it also had this patronage of the nobility. And in ancient Greece, it was the city that supported it. It needs support. And we live in a country now where the NEA has not grown in decades. You know, again, let's get some decent people in Congress so that we don't have to be afraid of it being turned into a political football to give the right gains in other areas. But, you know, the arts community, men and women and everybody else, isn't doing what they need to be doing to, you know, fight for, you know, public funding for the arts, because we believe that taxes are good, government is good, civilization is good. I think that that's a struggle that we need to engage in. So I don't know if that's, you know.
There. I know we've gone a little long, so if there's anybody who desperately needs to go to the bathroom, or if you had an appointment at 4 o'clock, don't be self-conscious about slipping out. We'll take a few questions. So in doing research for Lincoln and exploring Lincoln as a man, did you have a problem getting past a sort of like Christ-like aura that's been built up around Lincoln to get to the real person and the human being, the man?
I mean, I forget who it was. I think it was John Hay, his assistant secretary, said many years after he had been murdered, after he died, he said if we believe as he believed, that idea of democracy is the modern era's equivalent to religious faith, then we have to agree that Lincoln is its Christ. And I sort of believe that. So I don't think that he was Christ or that he was God. I think he was a human being, and there's certainly abundant evidence. The more I read about him, the more his complications and contradictions accumulated and accreted, and there are things about him that are very mysterious. There's very little that I found that made me dislike him. In fact, almost everything that I read made me love him even more and more, which is a real problem with working with him, because he was just an incredibly lovable guy. I mean, he was somebody that, you know, if you, I think, are a decent person, you're going to find the more you read about him, the more moved you are by his life and what he went through and what he accomplished and the way that he behaved. He had this unbelievably great sense of humor. He and I liked the same, poets, Robert Burns and Shakespeare, and he loved the theater.
A
little too much, right? When we were last year during the Academy Awards thing, this kid, we went to some horrible broadcast critics award ceremony, and they had some guy's nephew who was like 15 years old getting up and doing like Borscht Belt comedy, but he was actually funny, and he went through all the different nominees and he said, you know, and by the way, has everybody read the news? Lincoln is doing very well in theaters, which has not traditionally been the case. He had a temper. He was a very loving father who also took a kind of shockingly exhibited a shocking kind of negligence towards. I mean, in all the books I think I read like over 100 and something books in working on the film, I never read anyone mention, or anyone really actually disapprove of, the fact that Lincoln took his son Tad on his 12th birthday into Richmond during the walk through Richmond, which is really the most dramatic moment in the entire history of the American presidency, I think. But the city had just fallen. When they sailed down the river to Richmond, they were sailing under Confederate forts that were still flying the stars and bars, not because they were like refusing to surrender, but because they hadn't heard yet that Richmond had fallen. So they were there over the James River with guns. They went through submerged mines. Porter, the admiral who got Lincoln all the way to Richmond, said he didn't want to go with the kid. And Lincoln said, he said, it's too dangerous, you can't bring this boy. And Lincoln said, but it would break his heart if I left him behind. So he took him, which is exactly that kind of weird father that Lincoln was. But this kid could have been killed. I mean, he really could have been. And Lincoln loved him very much. What that was, I still, to this day, don't know. Why, having been shot at several times, you know, he was a very, very smart politician, obviously, and he made sure that he didn't take too many risks when he thought an election really mattered, and he knew that getting reelected as President of the United States, that everything about this country's history and the fate of democracy itself, I think, depended on his reelection, and it was not a sure thing. Still, at the point at which he was really clearly going to win, he made Andrew Johnson his new vice presidential. And he, you know, the danger of being no president had been assassinated yet, but there was a real danger of it. Lincoln had had premonitions about it. He must have known that so he sort of overstepped the caution by getting a border state guy who then turned out to be just a calamitous choice, the worst mistake Lincoln ever made, I think. But having said that, I knew that when I was writing this thing, I said no to doing it for 6 months, mainly because I think that there are these people. They come along very, very rarely. We call them geniuses because they're not like us. And they do things that people can't really do. And why they do them, how they do them, how Shakespeare, how George Eliot, how Mozart did the things they did, I have absolutely no idea. And politics is not a field in which it's easy to genius makes an easy residence, I think, because it's made up of a lot of weird things that fight against one another. He was, I think, one of the great minds of human history, and I knew that people would sort of expect me to explain how he did the things he did. And I knew that I could only fail, even if I seemed to. The more I seemed to have explained it, the more I would fail, because there's a mystery there that I don't think Lincoln himself understood. And you know, I calmed down when I remembered that my job was to write a character for an actor to fill, and as long as we got an actor of real, who could at least, you know, seem to be possessed of something somewhat beyond the ordinary and the human, we'd be okay. And we, you know, we got lucky. It's the first studio film about Lincoln, except for the vampire one, in 72 years. The first major film about Lincoln, except for one really hideous one that D.W. Griffith made to apologize for Birth of a Nation. It's the first film about Lincoln of any note that's about his presidency. And we just happened to arrive at it at a moment when arguably the greatest actor alive, certainly one of the greatest actors alive, is this guy who looks like Abraham Lincoln, and he could step in. And the minute Daniel said yes, I had already written like five drafts of the thing, but the Lincoln character himself began to come alive because I relaxed a little bit. I thought, okay, I'm going to believe. I don't know that I would believe anybody else. Everybody else, I thought, would probably look like, you know, somebody on a President's Day used car commercial. I've seen this guy. You know, there are just some actors. I don't know what it is. Some really great actors aren't this. Philip Seymour Hoffman, who I revere, you know, to the stars, was one of the greatest actors. But Phil was an incredibly fleshy, of-the-earth actor. But, you know, like Vanessa Redgrave, I mean, there are these people, sometimes Meryl Streep, who just seem in touch with something not quite available to the rest of us. And Daniel has that, and I think he brings that in the minute he comes on. It was just uncanny. And you read about that when you read people who met Lincoln, who knew Lincoln, who loved him. There was some part of him, everybody said, he's so warm, but he's also so cold. He's so immediate and available and fun to be with, and there's some part of him that's off somewhere else all the time. That's the part that could figure out how to make it certain that the 13th Amendment was introduced in 1860 to make slavery a constitutionally protected institution would be passed 4 years later, 5 years later, as the amendment that prohibits slavery. And I think that that arc owes more to Abraham Lincoln than anything else, any one single other single person. And that insight, that foresight, that all-encompassing gaze is, you know, you just have to be in awe of it. So that's...
I think we have time for one more, and it was going to be you.
Thank you both for this afternoon and for promising to be on Celebrity Husbands Club.
So if there were to be a part three to Angels in America that encompassed everything from the end of the original two to now, to 2014, what role would HIV/AIDS play in it? What themes? How would the HIV/AIDS theme extend? What story would you want to tell?
I mean, first of all, there won't ever be a third part because, you know, Godfather. I mean, I learned. Godfather 1, one of the greatest movies ever made. Godfather 2, absolutely one of maybe the great, you know, greatest American film. Godfather 3, well, you know, we won't talk about that. And it's like I
Intelligent Guy doesn't have HIV/AIDS.
It's mentioned.
It's mentioned, but it's not.
It's not addressed.
And in your interview with The Stranger this week, you decried the disappearance of HIV/AIDS, its discussion, its mentions, as a problem, because it's still a global pandemic, it still disproportionately impacts gay men in America, and yet it doesn't seem like a topic you yourself are interested in.
I mean, because I'm not at all certain that I won't go back to writing about the epidemic, which is now not an epidemic, it's a global pandemic, and, you know, it's... what Dan's referring to, I mean, when we did the play in 2010 and its 20th anniversary revival at the Signature, you know, it occurred to me that there was a new kind of silence surrounding AIDS, that in the early years of the epidemic, getting any kind of media attention to all these thousands of people who were dying from it was impossible because of homophobia. Now, because of first worldism, because of a you know, just obliviousness to the problems of the developing world, to an interference with news flowing from the parts of the globe that are most, you know, catastrophically affected with rampant HIV infection and all sorts of complications, it's kind of disappeared again. It's very hard to get anything like a sustained, and also nuclear numbing. It's the Robert J. Lifton problem. It's been around a long time. It's so devastating. You get to the point where you're just staring at this horror and it doesn't look like a horror anymore. It's just the landscape. And I think that probably I will want to write about it again, but I don't write about topics. I mean, that's the thing, is I do believe that Angels had a certain part to play at the moment that it appeared. When it appeared on Broadway in 93, it was right after Clinton had been elected for the first time. The antiretrovirals were really beginning to make an absolutely dramatic difference in longevity of seropositive people, and things were really changing. And I think the country as a whole began to feel enough of a lessening of the pressure of those horrible first years to begin to mourn. And when you're in a war, you mourn, but you mourn very differently than once peace is declared and then there's really room for full throttle grief to come out. And I think Angels arrived on Broadway. I mean, those first couple of years of the performances on Broadway, I mean, there was a lot of people that were there to see the play, but also to be in a room full of people who had lost people or who were dying or who were sick and weren't sure how they were going to do. And it's like the AIDS quilt. I mean, those things arrived at that moment and had an impact. And if the play has taught people about AIDS, if the productions all over the world have made people talk about gay people or, you know, AIDS in any way, I and a number of other writers have contributed to that, and I'm enormously proud of having done that. But I don't feel that the power of theater is primarily a polemic or pedagogical power. And I feel that maybe Brecht would hate me for saying this, but
he's a long dead playwright.
But he's a long dead playwright. Not in my head, he's not. But I really have come to believe more and more, you know, Shakespeare and Midsummer Night's Dream, that it's the power of the dream for the dreamer, and that the deal that you make is, we'll show you things that are sometimes horrible to behold. The reason you'll come and watch them is that you're not expected to do anything about them, and then we are not asking that you remember or understand what you're seeing, or that we have any control over what it's going to do to you. You're going to decide that when you wake up. You can remember the dream. You can misremember the dream, although as Freud says, there's no real misremembering of dreams. But you can remember it 10 years later. You can remember it in the middle of a day, and it'll ruin your whole day, and you'll walk out in front of a bus. I mean, you know, any number of things are possible. But you have made this deal with your unconscious to get this punny little riddle play in your head while you're prone on your bed and no risk to yourself or anybody else. And that's the power, and it's an indirect power. You let it out there, and then it's up to the community and each individual in the community to know what it's going to do. So I've never felt that I could write a play about a topic. I've written a couple of one acts. I wrote the Laura Bush play that I wrote about her reading, you know, and it wasn't even about a topic. It was because I was so upset that there was this, I went and I spoke at this march, maybe the largest march in the history of New York City against the Iraq War. In the freezing cold, over a million people came out. My speech was terrible. I can't do the sort of butch thing on the stage. I just feel like, who am I kidding? So it didn't work. But the march, standing on that stage and looking at this sea of people, and it was like 16 degrees below zero, it was freezing, and all these decent people were out saying no to this war. And then the next day they said to Bush, what do you think of that? These marches, it was New York and all over the place. And he said, well, it's like a focus group on television. And everybody was like, oh, that's so disgusting. I thought it was the only true thing the little jerk ever said, because that's what we were. We had given up, we had no representation or not enough representation in the halls of power to get what we wanted. So all we could do was let him know how unhappy we were and then go home and get warm again, and the war happened. So I wrote that play really in despair, and I, you know, it was used, and I'm really proud of it, again, that it was done in by anti-war groups all over the country. But it's, if you listen to it really carefully, it's a complicated little thing, and I just don't think that, I'm not a good propagandist or, you know, sort of creative public service, and I'm not denigrating public service announcements, they're important, but I don't know that my work or that theater in general really functions at its best doing that. So something's gonna have to happen where I start to feel, oh, there's some story here, there's some thing here that I can plunge into, and then we'll see. So you know, I'm not long dead yet. So who knows? We'll see what happens.
Tony Kushner.
Dan Sandler.